Good morning and welcome to the Middlebury First United Methodist Church. It's a pleasure to be here. Our sermon quote today is, "The Pledge of Allegiance reflects the truth that faith in God has played a significant role in America since the days of the founding of our country." We have a lot going on in our church, and so now Mike is going to share with us the announcements.
Good morning again, and welcome on this glorious 4th of July weekend. May we remember our freedoms, and God bless the United States of America. I would refer you to the bulletin and the newsletter for announcements and the calendar, because our main announcement this morning is to welcome our new pastor. Pastor Bob and Nancy Vale have made their move to Middlebury and are now residents of this community. Many of you have had the pleasure of already meeting them, but today I am honored to officially introduce Pastor Bob and Nancy Vale. Please come forward, you two, and in front of the altar, and Donna Carney representing Sisters of Strength and Catherine Wasson representing Staff Parish have an additional welcome for you. Did anyone drive a forklift in today?
Thank you.
Thank you.
On behalf of the Sisters of Strength, we welcome you to our church family and our community. So they've put together a lot of goodies.
Thank you. Thank God.
You're fine.
Stay here for a second. So Nancy and I have been so well received. As you know, we had the privilege of purchasing a home here in Middlebury, which was kind of a God story, and we'll tell you more about that. But so many of you have welcomed us, so we've enjoyed the Wednesday night supper. Some of you have come by and given us food and gifts, and we thank you for that. I want to kind of jump back about 3 months ago. Nancy's mother, 91 years old, passed away. And so many of you, even though we were still at LaPorte, sent cards and letters of, sympathy. And so thank you so much for that. And so we look so forward to being your clergy couple and being here years together as we make disciples for Jesus Christ. And so thank you so much. As we begin our time of worship, let's bow our heads and hearts for our musical call to worship with the chancel choir singing, "I Love You, Lord."
To worship you, oh my.
Thank you, choir. Would you please stand as you are able and join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed as printed in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, would Linda please come forward and share our children's moment?
Okay, if the children will come up here and sit down, that would be great. So let's see, we have more kids up here. Yeah. All right. That's good. Hi, Claire and Emma. Good to have you. Do you want to sit down? Yeah, you can sit down there. And, good. And Claire, how old are you?
Four.
Four. And how old are you, Emma? How old are you?
Seven.
Seven. Well, that's great. That's wonderful. Do you know what tomorrow is? Do you know what?
4th of July.
The 4th of July. Why don't you scoot down here so we can get you a little bit more and we can hear what you're saying there, okay? Yeah, the 4th of July is tomorrow, isn't it? Are you excited about that?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're going to do lots of things, aren't you? Right. Well, do you know that tomorrow is the birthday of our nation? And you know how old we are, how many years that we've been a country? Do you know how many? 276 years. 276, it seems like it was just a little while ago, it was 200, but it's 276 years that we have had birthdays. That's a lot of birthdays, isn't it? Yeah. And so tomorrow we're going to celebrate that day as our independence from Great Britain, and it's a birthday. What do you like most about celebrating birthdays? What do you like most? Tell me. What do you like about birthdays?
Balloons.
Balloons. Balloons.
Balloons. Okay. How about Emma? What do you like most?
Seeing my friends.
Seeing her friends.
That's great. Well, tomorrow we're going to be doing lots of things, and I love birthdays. I love to go to birthdays because you have games, and you have cake and ice cream, and you get to celebrate, and sometimes people will give presents, and it's a wonderful time to have. And so I love to go to birthday parties, and then tomorrow we're going to be doing some things too. We're going to be doing barbecues and games, maybe flag football even. And we're going to have fireworks and lots of noise. It's going to be lots of fun. And we also have decorations at birthdays, like balloons. You like balloons. What's your favorite color of balloon?
Pink.
Pink. Yeah, pink. That's one of my favorites, too. But we have decorations for the 4th of July. And what's this? What is that?
A flag.
Right, it's a flag, and it's our country's flag, isn't it? And it's something that we see a lot of. Today, when I came to down to the church here, there was lots of flags out. I could see them all over. And so it reminds us of the birth of our country and the love that we have and the loyalty we have for our country and that God is our ruler of it. And we have a promise. When we have a like when we go to school, do you say the Pledge of Allegiance?
Yeah.
What grade are you in?
Fourth.
Fourth grade. So you say the Pledge of Allegiance. That's a promise we give to God and our country, isn't it? And, you know, some people, they cover their heart when they say the pledge. And sometimes when the flag goes by, they'll stand out of respect for the flag. And it's really great to have God as our guide and our leader And God gives us some rules for our country. Do you know what the rules are in the Bible? There's 10 of them. Do you know what those rules are? Do you know?
There's 10.
10 commandments. Yeah. Honor my father and mother.
Oh, that's a good rule. That's one of them. I can't remember which one, but there's 10 of them, aren't they? Yes. That's your parents taught you right. Yeah, that's for sure. And so those are rules for us to follow. But you know what? You know, tomorrow is the birthday of our country. But, you know, I was told once that the two most important days of our lives are the day that we're born and the day that we find out why. They're two most important days. And God has a purpose for you and me, and he has a purpose for everybody here, and he has a purpose for our nation, too. It was born on a certain day 276 years ago, and that purpose includes him. And we always have to remember that. And we should never leave God out of it. And so we're called to serve and to love other people. And he's going to help us do that. And I hope tomorrow that you have a great day. What are you going to do tomorrow?
Have fireworks at my nene's.
Okay. I have fireworks at her nene's.
And do you know what we're going to do tomorrow?
Are you going to go see a parade?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, parades. So you're going to see a lot of these at the parade, aren't you? Well, let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you for these children, how precious they are. And we just pray that as we celebrate tomorrow, we'll remind ourselves of the freedom that we have and of the freedom that we have in your Son, Jesus Christ. We love you today. And we just pray that as we see our lives unfolding and the purpose that you have for us and for our nation, that we'll have you included. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. Our hymn of praise this morning is the hymn song, God of the Ages. In your hymn book, that's on page 698. The words are on the screen. Let's stand together as we sing this hymn of praise, God of the Ages.
Thank you.
particular time, we'd like to pass the peace. And the way I'd like for us to do that is to turn around and wave to those and say, welcome to God's house. Welcome. So let's turn around and pass the peace and just say, welcome. You may be seated. I have a practice and tradition that when we go to our time of prayer, I like to ask the church family if there's any specific prayer requests that you might have that I could add to my prayers this morning. Now, as we move into this, I will do this from week to week. And so if you have one, just simply raise your hand and let me know. I'll write it down and then I'll be in prayer for that. If for some reason we get to the practice where this lasts 15 minutes, we may change the direction of that. And we may just have you write that down as you come into the church, and then it'll be brought to me. So at this time, does anyone have a prayer request that you'd like to share with the church family? Yes. So that Henry would eat more. Yeah. I wish I had that problem that I could. Okay, so we're going to pray for Henry, a little baby that needs to eat more. Someone else had their hand up. Yes, ma'am.
I would like you to pray for my mom and dad, Amanda and Elmer Christner.
Amanda and Elmer. Any others? Yes, ma'am.
Please pray for Kathy and her two girls as they leave on a big trip for them. They'll be gone the entire month.
Any others? Yes.
My brother Randy is having a heart catheterization on Wednesday.
And his name is Randy. Any others? Now, yes. Okay. So peace in Ukraine. Ask God to open doors and windows and healing and bring peace to that part of the world. Any others? So when we go through this prayer time and these are mentioned, if you have the opportunity, maybe write them out, because we don't just want this to be just a one-time Sunday morning. So continue to pray for them during the week. If you forget, then watch the live stream on Monday and you can capture those as well. Our prayer hymn as we go into our time of prayer is Abide With Me, and verse 1, it's on page 700, and so let's remain seated and sing that together as we go into our time of prayer. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we begin with the war in Ukraine, that it would become peace in Ukraine, that you would work with the leaders, work behind the scenes in ways that we never see or know to somehow bring peace. Be with those families who have lost loved ones on both sides. But Lord, we ask for peace. Lord, we pray for Henry and Hazel, that Henry would eat more. Pray for Amanda and Elmer. Pray for Kathy and the two girls as they go on the trip. And also Randy as he has heart cath surgery. Heavenly Father, listen to our prayers today. Allow us to share the thoughts and prayers up to your throne. Allow us to honor and adore you. If needed, to confess our sins, our failures, and to allow us to thank you for the many blessings in this life, big and small. And may we humbly make our requests and petitions to you, our Jehovah Jireh, our provider, our protector, our great shepherd. May you bless the people of the Middlebury United Methodist Church who come to worship you today on this Sabbath. Lord, teach us your ways. Teach us to be more of your disciple through prayer, through Bible study, through meditation, through reflection, through giving and serving and helping and evangelizing. Oh, Lord, offer grace to the hopeless. Present mercy when it is undeserved. Giving food and water to the hungry and thirsty and peace to a broken world. Abba, Father, reveal yourself through your Holy Spirit. Send us out into the mission field of Middlebury, filled with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and hope. In other words, allow us to be God with skin on today. Be revealed in our lives at the workplace, the marketplace, the home place, and especially among our family and friends this holiday weekend. Finally, Lord, on this 4th of July weekend, as we honor freedom and liberty for all, perhaps now more than ever at this time in our history, bring us into unity as a country. Where anger and division are taking root, please grow a tree of love and peace. Break down the walls that divide us and build a bridge working together that unites us. May we stop seeing people through the eyes of liberal or conservative, right or left, black or white, brown or yellow, rich or poor, LGBTQ or straight or strong or weak, the north side of town, the south side of town, and may we just see people as Jesus sees people, with open arms, with compassion, with welcome, with forgiving gestures of reconciliation, with a burden to help the least of these. Oh, may we love our neighbor, sweet love that will change the world forever. Lord, be with us today as we worship you. And we thank you for the country that we live in with so many freedoms. And so bless us this day with music, with scripture, with preaching, and with the love of many being together. We continue our time of prayer as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Whether our tithe or an additional offering, we give back to God so that the work of his church may continue. Thank you for sharing your generosity of spirit in a tangible way. Please join me in the offertory sentence. The meaning of life is to find your gift. The purpose of life is to give it away to others. Would the usher please come forward with the offering plates while we listen to the offertory?
Thank you.
Let's stand together for the doxology of praise. Gifts from your people, may you bless them. May you make the world a better place from our gifts and resources and talents and treasures. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, Amen. Thank you. Maybe see.
As members of this congregation, we have embarked on a mission to create a fellowship built on faith and reflecting Christian love and understanding. We have journeyed together, committed to serving the Lord and guided by His Spirit. On this special day, we pause in our journey to celebrate with joy and give thanks to God for bringing us to this time and place.
We are bound to.
Thank you, choir. The scripture lesson today comes from Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, verse 13. Listen to this brief but powerful statement. You, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge in the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. May God add his blessing to this reading.
Today I want to talk to you on this 4th of July weekend about the Pledge of Allegiance. How many of you remember as a child in school standing up and reciting the Pledge of Allegiance? That was something that we did. My wife is a 4th grade school teacher, and they still recite that if they want. It's a little bit different than what we were doing, because if I didn't recite it, you know, I was in trouble. And so we did that. But there's a lot to be learned from that. One of the verses I want to start out with that I think is good is Psalm 33:12. It says, God's hand rest on those who follow him. That's you and me. That's you and me. Those of you that follow the Lord, God's hand rest on you, and you are blessed. And then it goes on, says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Don't you pray and hope that's the United States of America, that we say in God we trust, and in saying so and believing so and doing so, that God would indeed bless us, the people he has chosen as his own inheritance. Now, as we begin to look at the Pledge of Allegiance, I also want to recognize this flag. Okay, now, so this is the Christian flag, and I just want to talk briefly about that, because the Christian flag has a pledge also. It says, I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe. Now, I'll never forget, I grew up in New Paris, Indiana, and I went to the Grace United Methodist Church. As a young boy, Grace United Methodist Church meant that I went to the gum church, Grace United Methodist. And then in vacation Bible school, I went out in the country to the Solomon Creek United Methodist Church. And as a little boy, we called that the scum church. That was just us as little boys. But I remember learning that. And how many of you remember maybe learning the pledge to the Bible? The pledge to the Bible goes like this. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light to my path, and will hide its words in my heart, that I might not sin against God. Folks, this is our living manual. This is the Bible that we love, we care for, we read. I like to say this about the Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have, and I can do what it says I can do. Amen? That's our Bible. So today I want to talk to you about the Pledge of Allegiance to the American flag. The Pledge of Allegiance to the United States of America is an expression of allegiance to the American flag of the United States and to the Republic of the United States of America. Such a pledge was first composed with a text different from the one used at the present by Captain George Thatcher, a Union Army officer during the Civil War, and later a teacher of patriotism in the New York City schools. The form of the pledge used today was largely devised by Francis Bellamy in 1892 and formally adopted by Congress as the pledge 50 years later in 1942. The official name, the Pledge of Allegiance, was adopted in 1945. The most recent alteration of its wording came on Flag Day, June 14th, 1954, when the words under God were placed there. So, let's look more detailed at our pledge. First of all, it says, I pledge allegiance. To pledge allegiance is to acknowledge that as individuals, you and I, we dedicate all that we are, all that we have, and all that we will have to our beloved country. We align ourselves with the values of freedom for everyone, equality for everyone, liberty for everyone, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, how many in here, male or female, served in the military? Raise your hand if you served in it. Do you remember getting up first thing in the morning, 6 a.m., and what'd we do? Reveille. And we stood out, and we stood at attention, and that flag went up. And then at 6 o'clock in the evening, we went out again, and we stood as taps was played, letting us know that the day had ended. Every day, every year, We did that. One of the things that happens when you serve in the military is you realize that freedoms are not free. They come at a cost. And that particular cost are men and women who serve around this world and protect the freedoms that we have. You and I enjoy freedom of speech, but it's not the politician that gives us freedom of speech. It's the soldier who serves in this country, outside of this country, our police officers, those who serve, our first responders that help protect that. And then it goes on to the flag of the United States of America, and we are pledging allegiance to the U.S. symbol of a flag. What is the flag symbolic of? The stars are symbolic of the heavens and the goals to which humankind aspires. Stripes are symbols of rays of light from the sun. The 13 stripes represent the original 13 colonies that declared independence from England. 50 stars symbolize the current 50 United States. White signifies purity, innocence, and red signifies valor and bravery, and blue signifies vigilance, perseverance, and justice. So when you wave that flag at a parade, when you have that on your front porch, on the flagpole in the front yard, look at the symbolism. How deep it is, how rich it is. And then we go on to say, and to the republic for which it stands, in our country, we get to vote for people to stand up for us and make the laws that we obey. This is called a republic. Our elected leaders represent the voices of the people who should always listen to us and be responsible. We as a nation, of the people, by the people, we do not have a king or queen who lords over us as a nation. All the people, you and I, have a single voice in our vote and representative. And then it goes, one nation under God. No matter who we are, what we believe, or where we may originally be from, we are a part of the same team. And we believe that there is a higher power, a greater thing than ourselves, looking out for us. Not only looking out for us, but encouraging us to be a nation of honesty, of integrity, of strength, of compassion, to look out for the poor, look out for the hurting and the marginalized in our country. I believe that God raised the United States to be a beacon for religious freedom that takes the gospel of Jesus Christ out to the world. From the halls of Bible colleges, seminaries, church auditoriums, men and women over the centuries have gone to become missionaries in different parts of the world. The word nation is actually mentioned 425 times in the Bible. Did you know that? God loves nations and wants them to follow them. Throughout our global history, God has worked with nations. In the Bible, nations rise and fall according to a pattern. When nations remember God, the nations rose. When they forgot God, they fell. Did you hear that? When nations remember God, nations rose. When they forgot God, they fell. I was a young soldier in Germany in 1989. That was the year that the wall fell. That was the year that Russia collapsed. I'll never forget being in Germany and driving on the Autobahn and seeing these folks from Eastern Germany driving in their Traubis to get away from oppression. And when their car broke down, they didn't care. They grabbed their suitcases, left that thing on the side of the road because they just wanted to get out of a place where they didn't have the freedoms that you and I enjoy. One of the things that happened the next year or so in Russia is Russia began to look at themselves. And where the last 20 or 30 years they pushed God out of their culture, they realized that that was wrong. They realized that that was wrong to push God out of their culture, and they began to invite other church groups into Russia again. As I look at our country over the past 20 or 30 years, I wonder if maybe little by little we're doing the same thing, pushing God out of our culture. When nations remember God, the nations rose. When they forgot God, they fell. I want to read some thoughts of some of our presidents about how God was involved at the very beginning of our nation. Here's something from George Washington, the first president, once said, "It is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey His will, to be grateful for His benefits, and to humbly implore His protection and favor." Thomas Jefferson, the third president, stated at Thanksgiving Proclamation, October 3rd, 1789, "God who gave us life gave us liberty. Can the liberties of a nation be secure when we have removed a conviction that these liberties are a gift from God?" If you go to Washington, D.C., you can read on the Jefferson Memorial, "The fundamental basis of the nation's laws were given to us by Moses and the Ten Commandments." The fundamental basis of the Bill of Rights comes from the teachings from the Ten Commandments. Dwight Eisenhower, the 34th president, once said, "Without God, there could be no American form of government, nor an American way of life. Recognition of the supreme being is first and most basic expression of Americanism. Thus founding fathers saw it, and thus, with God's help, it will continue to be." Ronald Reagan, our 40th president, once said, "If we ever forget that we're one nation under God, then perhaps we'll be a nation gone under." And then we get to the part of the pledge that says this one word, indivisible. Indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. This means that we are stronger together and that no one can break us apart. How many of you feel today in July 3rd, 2022, that we as a nation are united? We're not. That word indivisible has somewhat taken a beating over the past 20 to 25 years. In my opinion, the word indivisible has taken a beating over the past 20 to 25 years in America. Indivisible means that nothing can separate us. No outside foreign power, no inner domestic threat can tear us apart. However, as Americans, I feel that we are perhaps more separated than divided now since the dark days of the Civil War. As Americans, we cannot seem to agree on many social, political, and religious differences of opinion. We cannot agree on the southern border, immigration differences of opinion. We disagree on environmental climate changes differences. We struggle with opposing view of racial disparity. We have sharp political differences of opinion. Surprisingly, we have 3,000 different denominations in the United States. 3,000. We have differences on the LGBTQIA differences. We, since 1973, have had abortion rights to life, and that has changed somewhat in the past couple weeks. We have differences of opinions on the COVID pandemic, differences of opinion, and the list goes on things that divide us rather than what unites us. If the obvious differences were not enough, we have today's technology at our fingertips that remind us of our differences through 24/7 news television, the debates that go on between CNN or Fox News or MSNBC. You know, I'm watching a lot more sports these days. I'm watching a lot more sports just because you can get caught up in it, can't you? And if that's not enough, we have our car radio. Each side explains why they are right and the other is wrong for our country and the hypocrisy that each one shows. I have a question for you. How can we get back to being indivisible again? How can we as a nation get back to being united again? Can our relationship with Jesus Christ make a difference in our corner of the world? Now, if I were to come to you and say, you know, I used to live in Savannah, Georgia, and I'd like for us to go and let's make a difference in Savannah, Georgia. I don't know how many of us would be willing to drive down to Savannah, Georgia. I used to live in Stuttgart, Germany when I was in the military. And if I said, hey, let's go to Stuttgart, Germany, and let's make a difference in Stuttgart, Germany. I don't know how much we can do. But if I said, let's make a difference in Middlebury, in Shipshewana, in Goshen and Elkhart and your little corner of the world. And the Holy Spirit that resides in you says, love people, care for people, take care of the poor. Our little corner of the world in Middlebury and surrounding country communities, we could make a difference. Amen? We can. You can do it with Christ in your heart and living out that faith. Let's not worry about Savannah or Stuttgart, Germany. Let's just care for our own backyard. Is it even possible to be indivisible with a free country of ideas, speech, and opinion? As a student of history, it seems that the last time we were unified as a nation was the bombing of Pearl Harbor and the entrance of World War II. Perhaps at the first Gulf War when we freed the small nation of Kuwait from Iraq. The tragic events of 9/11, how many of you remember that? When we became a nation of prayer. When that happened, we were united. Somehow there needs to be a solution towards a more unified and indivisible nation. And I believe the Christian faith can help us with that. Amen. Each one of us loving and caring. What made the church grow in Acts 2? It was love. Oh, they just loved each other. And perhaps love is the way. Perhaps love is the way. Next is liberty. Liberty and justice for all. Liberty is the state of being within a society that does not have a king or queen. We are our own people. We the people. And then there's justice. Justice in its broadest sense is the principle that we receive that which we deserve. The United States justice is our legal practice. There's a lot of things that are injustice in our country, our history, that need to be reconciled, that need to be forgiven. And then the word all, that encompasses everyone. Everyone who loves America, who comes to America, rich, poor, young and old, whether you live on the good side of the tracks or the bad side of the railroad tracks, it means everyone, all colors, all creeds, all collection of people. If we truly believe and live out the three words of liberty and justice for all, then perhaps we have a chance at equality. As a Christian and as a pastor, there are two words I really wish that were in the Pledge of Allegiance. And there are two words that are part of the Bible in so many ways, and that's peace and love. I wish peace and love was in there somewhere, but perhaps it's not, but that we can contribute that with our Christian lives. Amen? Perhaps we can do that. How many of you remember the comedian Red Skelton? You remember Red Skelton? He's from Vincennes, Indiana. My son went to school there and got to learn a little bit more of the history of them. But he has this wonderful explanation of the Pledge of Allegiance that I want us to hear. Let's listen to it together.
I remember a teacher that I had. Now, I went through the seventh grade. I went to the seventh grade. I left home when I was 10 years old because I was hungry. And I used to, this is true. I work in the summer and I go to school in the winter. But I had this one teacher. He was the principal of the Harrison School in Vincennes, Indiana. To me, this was the greatest teacher, a real sage of my time, anyhow. He had such wisdom. And we were all reciting the Pledge of Allegiance one day. And he walked over, this little old teacher. Mr. Laswell was his name. Mr. Laswell, he says, I've been listening to you boys and girls recite the Pledge of Allegiance all semester, and it seems as though it's becoming monotonous to you. If I may I recite it and try to explain to you the meaning of each word? I, me, an individual, a committee of one, pledge, dedicate all of my worldly goods to give without self-pity. Allegiance, my love and my devotion to the flag, our standard, O glory, a symbol of freedom Wherever she waves, there's respect. Because your loyalty has given her a dignity that shouts, freedom is everybody's job. United. That means that we have all come together. States. Individual communities that have united into 48 great states. 48 individual communities with pride and dignity and purpose. All divided with imaginary boundaries, yet united to a common purpose. And that's love for country. And to the Republic. Republic. A state in which sovereign power is invested in representatives chosen by the people to govern. And government is the people. And it's from the people to the leaders, not from the leaders to the people, for which it stands. One nation, meaning so blessed by God, indivisible, incapable of being divided, with liberty, which is freedom, the right of power to live one's own life, without threats, fear, or some sort of retaliation. And justice, the principle or qualities of dealing fairly with others. For all. For all. Which means, boys and girls, it's as much your country as it is mine. And now, boys and girls, let me hear you recite the pledge of allegiance.
Let's stand together.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Since I was a small boy, two states have been added to our country and two words have been added to the Pledge of Allegiance. Under God. Wouldn't it be a pity if someone said that is a prayer and that would be eliminated from schools too?
As we continue to walk into this 4th of July weekend, I pray that the words of the Pledge of Allegiance, this sermon, has challenged you and it blesses your experience. Let's pray together. Lord, help us to live out the words, the principles of the Pledge of Allegiance, particularly one nation under God. We are thankful that we are one nation under God. Be our guiding light among the nations. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning is America on page 697. The words are on the screen. Let's stand together. America, 697.
Thank you.
share something with you. As much as you folks have given us surprises and welcomed us, there is a dear friend of mine who is my fishing buddy that is here today. And he actually grew up in the Elkhart area and started preaching and becoming a Methodist minister. And he became bishop. He is the bishop in Illinois. And his name is Bishop Frank Beard and his wife, Melissa. Thank you so much for coming on my first Sunday. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Welcome to the bishop. Well, thank you for allowing me a few moments this morning to share some things that are happening here at FUMC. And I can't think of a more appropriate day to share this with the congregation and on Pastor Bob and Nancy's first day. I'm going to admit I'm a little nervous and have been this morning with excitement. But if you see me hopping around a little bit up here, it's not because I'm nervous. It's because I have poison ivy inside my left calf. So. Pastor Bob walked through our doors with a plan in his hand, ready to tackle the priorities here at FUMC Middlebury. As a result, he has made several staffing suggestions. In the past 30 days, those suggestions have run through the process of discussion and approval by staff parish, finance, and administrative council. I'd like to share those with you today. First, we are addressing the dual needs of our youth and our future growth. We are putting the finishing touches on job descriptions this month, and we'll be posting jobs for the part-time positions of youth director and children's director. Ideally, these jobs will be filled by local persons. So we're actually asking you, the congregation, to network within the community for prospective candidates. Please watch our website for the updates and the job posting, and I anticipate it'll just be a few days and that posting will be up. Next, we are addressing the need to grow our alternative worship opportunities. And we're going to look at adding a well-staffed and well-led second worship service. We will also be posting then for a part-time praise and worship director to help propel us forward in this mission. Next, we address the vacancies in our choir leadership. I am very pleased today to announce that Nancy Vale has accepted the position of bell choir director, and Rex Gleim has accepted the position of chancel choir director. Now, for the budget-minded here today, please know that the funding for these positions is already in our payroll budget for this year. I now call your attention to a letter that Pastor Bob wrote in today's newsletter. In it, he asks us to dream and envision our future. And that future may well include a Christian preschool, and we are pursuing that. We are in the process of building an 8-person board of directors and tasking them with creating a blueprint for the preschool and in governing it if it comes to fruition. I ask you to pray about this as we proceed, and the congregation will receive updates as progress is made. Later this month, Bob and Nancy have a wonderful opportunity to travel to Vietnam for the wedding ceremony of their son and daughter-in-law. And this will be the second ceremony for them. This trip was originally postponed due to COVID, and they now get to complete this important component of that marriage for their daughter-in-law's family. They will be absent July 31st, and Pastor Ron will be filling the pulpit. That will be Ron and Lori's first day in attendance with us at FUMC. That's all I've got. After the benediction.
A So just briefly, Nancy and I have been married 38 years. We actually met at Fort Wayne Bible College, and she's from California, and I'm from the Midwest. And so it's kind of opposites, you know, and you'll learn that there's a lot of opposites in our relationship, but opposites attract, and so that's wonderful. So we've been married 38 years. We had three children, Rebecca, Josh, and Daniel. As many of you may know, our youngest, Daniel, passed away a year and a half ago. And so he's with the Lord in heaven. We look forward to seeing him again one day. Our oldest daughter is a Purdue graduate in engineering and lives in Washington, D.C. with her husband, Will, who works on Capitol Hill. He works for a congressman as part of his staff and is also going through law school. No grandchildren yet. We're praying and hoping that will happen one day. So they're saying after law school that may happen, so we look forward to that. Our son and daughter-in-law, Joshua and PQ stands for Fun Quinn, they met in Chicago, and her family is first generation from Vietnam. And so they were married 3 years ago in La Porte, but they wanted to have that marriage in Vietnam with all of her family, and that was really important to her. And so COVID stopped that. We weren't able to go in April of 2020 like we had wanted to. Since that time, she's gone down to North Carolina and has just completed her physician's assistant schooling and will graduate here in a couple weeks. And then a couple weeks later, we're all going to Vietnam to be a part of that. So thank you to the SBRC and leadership for letting Nancy and I go to celebrate with them on that moment. Nancy is a teacher in South Bend at Monroe Elementary School, fourth grade. And so she'll be making that drive to and from each day when school starts. She will be leading the handbell choir voluntarily. She looks forward to that. She's done that in the past, and so she looks forward to that. We are just so tickled to be your clergy couple and your pastor. And we look forward to getting to know you and ministering with you and partnering with you in the years ahead. On two different occasions, we had opportunity to be with Pastor Ron. What a wonderful, wonderful Christian man. And just a couple days ago, we met with Lori, too. And so we are just so happy to be partnering with them. We want you to pray for us as we seek out a part-time youth minister, a part-time children's minister, a part-time praise and worship leader, that we can start a second service sometime down the road. And so we've got a lot of ideas, but we can't do it ourselves. We need you to put the aprons of work on and be a part of the team. Amen? And so it is a joy to be your clergy couple. Did you want to say anything or not?
I just want to thank you so much for the warm welcome we've had. It's been a real joy to be here, and we're really excited.
Yeah. And the choir is going to share with us our choral benediction. Let's stand together as they give the choral benediction.
Sunshine.
And now for the benediction and the blessing. May the strength of God sustain us. May the power of God preserve us. May the hands of God protect us. And may the way of God direct us. And may the love of God go with us this day and forever until we meet again. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you all. Have a great day. Thank you.